Welcome, everybody. In this video, Larry and I are going to talk about the executive order guidance that came out on Friday, making changes to the continuous work and safe harbor provisions with regards to solar. So welcome, Larry.
Thanks, Warren.
Yeah, just to recap everybody, that the One Big Beautiful Bill passed and really had substantial changes to ending the tax credits for solar. In terms of the residential tax credit, this executive order has no impact. The residential tax credit will continue to end on December 31st. If your project's not installed by then, you're not eligible for the tax credit. That hasn't changed. And what we're going to talk about today has no impact on residential. That's still in place. It does, however, have an impact on commercial and agricultural projects, big and small, that we have had a lot of uncertainty with up until now, because on the Monday morning after the 4th of July, President Trump signed an executive order to end market distortions, in other words, to go after the safe harboring and making it more challenging to put projects in the pipeline and backlog projects for future dates. And there's a lot of uncertainty surrounding that, and we finally got some clarity for the most part on Friday, and that's what we're going to talk about here in this video. So Larry, why don't we start off with where we were maybe prior to the executive order coming out on Friday, what we understood as the safe harboring process for commercial and ag projects.
Yeah, so there were two ways to safe harbor in the past, Warren. It's been this way for years. One was the 5% safe harbor, where the customer signs a contract with a contractor. They put down 5% of the total cost of the project to that contractor, and that contractor spends that 5% on actual products that will be used for that project: solar panels, inverters, racking, et cetera. That was the one way. The other way was the physical start test or physical construction start. And basically, that was a lot less clear. You could start construction on site. You could start construction at a manufacturer with a product that's not an off-the-shelf product that's made specifically for that project. So there are a couple ways to do that, but a lot less clear. So that's where we were before this executive order, this updated guidance came out.
Correct. And if we could just talk really quickly, Larry, about the specific dates that we were pushing up against prior to the executive order. Obviously, we were waiting. The guidance was supposed to come out within 45 days from the time the executive order was signed, and it did. It came out on Friday. But the key dates of the end of this year, maybe July 5th of next year, and then the 2027, and those dates, if you want to just really break that down really quickly so everybody has an understanding of that.
Yep. So the deadlines right now, as it currently stands, obviously, end of 2025 for residential, you mentioned that already.
Yeah.
And end of 2027 for commercial projects. Need to be placed in service by end of 2027. The only way to get around that is if you start construction by July 4th of 2026, then from the year that you started construction, you have four calendar years after that to complete the project. And so just, you know, if you start construction in 2025, 26, 27, 28, 29, you have the end of 2029 to build the project. If you start construction in 2026, you have till the end of 2030 to build that project. The other deadline that you mentioned is end of the year. Projects that don't start construction by the end of the year will be subject to the FEOC requirements, which is going to affect what products you can use in the project. It's going to affect where those products can be manufactured, where those products, what companies they come from based on where the companies are located, and who owns them and who's invested in those companies. So there's going to be fewer and probably more expensive components that will be needed to use for projects that start after the end of the year.
Right. And so leading up to this executive order, there was a lot of fear, uncertainty, mm-hmm. chit-chat that potentially mm-hmm. that 5% would go to 20%, maybe 50% in order to safe harbor using the down payment method, and that possibly it would go away. And then there was also some chatter about potentially that four-year window shrinking down to mm-hmm. 2.5, 3 years, maybe 1 year, that possibly going away as well. So, and Let's start off maybe with talking about large projects and what came out of that in terms of the 5% safe harbor and the physical work test for projects that are over 1.5 megawatts AC.
Yeah, so there were, I would say, Warren, there were three kind of big surprises in this bill. One was that it came out on Friday. The expectation was it would come out today or maybe, you know, Wednesday of this week, sometime this week. So that was kind of the first surprise. The second surprise is that they completely took away the 5% safe harbor for large projects, gone completely. That was the other surprise. That was expected to maybe go up in percentage, not necessarily go away completely. But the third surprise is that the whole thing is less challenging for solar than expected. And I'll just start with the large projects, like you mentioned there, Warren, just kind of explain how that works for large projects. So for projects over 1.5 megawatts AC, you can still use the 5% safe harbor and the current physical work test up until September 2nd. Now, that's not much time. September 1st is a holiday, so you really had 2 weeks from Friday to use those two tests for projects over 1.5 megawatts. After that, the 5% goes away completely for those projects. No option to 5% safe harbor. And even the physical work test is less clear. So there were some wording updates in this guidance. I'm not going to go into details, but there's some wording updates in this guidance that make it even more ambiguous, less clear than before. It was already not very clear, and now it's even less clear to be able to do that physical work test. I think it's still possible. It's just a little bit trickier to meet that.
Right. So the 5% safe harbor after September 2nd is going away for large projects over 1 megawatt AC. They will have to after that date, if they want to safe harbor, is follow the physical work test in order to get the tax credits. What about for projects that are distributed solar under 1.5 megawatts AC?
And just to be clear, this is projects that are 1.5 megawatts and under. So if you're exactly 1.5 megawatts AC, you still fall into the smaller project category. For those projects, my initial read of the guidance is that they can still 5% safe harbor just like they always have. So as long as those projects 5% safe harbor by the end of the year, they can avoid FEOC. And by July 4th of next year, they can build within 4 calendar years of the year that they safe harbored and be okay. They can also follow the physical work test, but for projects that are 1.5 megawatts and under, they have the same lack of clarity for the physical work test as the large projects if they want to follow that standard for start of construction.
So for projects that are under 1.5 megawatts AC or under, the 5% safe harbor provision remains, the 4 years to install it still remains. But also, if you don't want to go the 5%, you can still do the physical work tests, given that ambiguity that's surrounding it.
Yeah. And again, you have until September 2nd. If you're 1.5 megawatts and under, you do have until September 2nd to safe harbor under the old physical work test guidance. So that is a potential. I don't really see a lot of people going that route, but that is a potential.
So now we also were expecting, but it didn't happen, Larry, that tighter FEOC restrictions would be included in this guidance.
Mm-hmm. Yep.
When are we expecting that, and what are you expecting from that?
You know, Warren, I do not know. Unfortunately, I do not have a good read on what to expect there. But they were very clear in this guidance that this is not guidance around FEOC, and that's to come. And there's two things with the FEOC guidance that's coming out that could be affected here. One is just the requirements. They're probably going to tighten those requirements, make it more challenging to comply with those requirements, again, for projects that start construction after the end of this year. The second thing is they might try to adjust the wording of how you start construction for projects related to FEOC. Now, there's not a whole lot they can do because the bill, the One Big Beautiful Bill, made it very clear how you start construction related to FEOC. So I don't think there's a whole lot they can do, but they might try to do something with that, with the guidance that comes out related to FEOC.
But would it be, and maybe this is just an assumption, it was a part of the initial executive order So you would think it would still have to fall within that 45-day time frame. So we should hopefully, if they follow that, hear about it soon. And I think it would be also safe to assume that nothing in, hopefully, will be retroactive with regards to the FEOC requirements, since there was nothing retroactive in the safe harbor provisions. I highly doubt that anything FEOC related would be.
It seems highly unlikely, Warren. There was a little bit of concern that they might try to make this guidance retroactive, but most people that I was listening to were saying it's highly unlikely because it would just get challenged in court. It would break precedent. It doesn't seem likely. And fortunately, this guidance, it's not retroactive, and you actually have two additional weeks here to comply with it. And I would expect something similar for FEOC as well.
Yeah. So let's just recap where we are here, Larry, and feel free to jump in if I misstated anything. But based on the guidance from this executive order, large projects over a megawatt AC have until September 2nd. A megawatt and a half AC have until September 2nd of this year in order to still use the 5% safe harbor. And the quote unquote older version of physical work test requirements. After September 2nd, the 5% safe harbor no longer is an option for those projects, and they'll have to comply with the more ambiguous lack of clarity with regards to the physical work test. Projects that are 1.5 megawatts AC or smaller can still use the 5% safe harbor rule or the new guidance for the physical work test, and they will still have the 4 years to install it, 4 full calendar years from the time that they safe harbor that project.
Yeah, that's a good analysis, Warren. One other thing I'll mention is that there's additional lack of clarity in this guidance around what makes separate projects. So in the past, it was somewhat clear, you know, if I build a project that's a megawatt AC and I come back 3 years later and build another project that's a megawatt AC, I can show them as separate projects depending on how I build them and how I develop them. Today, that's less clear. I don't have a real good read on that yet. Hopefully we'll get some more understanding of this as time goes on. But right now it does appear like if you're doing an add-on project, you have to add the AC output of both projects together to figure out if you're over 1.5 megawatts AC or under. You have to take the projects combined. Now, obviously a project that's installed, you know, it's not going to be retroactive to that project. So there's a little bit of lack of clarity as to what makes a single project by itself and what makes a larger combined project.
Right. I think that's why the quote unquote integrated operations needs to be mm-hmm. clarified. But
yep.
Clearly they're trying to prevent multiple projects being sliced into many smaller projects for the same business at the same location as the same project. Well, Larry, that's very helpful. As soon as we get more guidance on FEOC, we'll put another video out there. And if we get any updated or new guidance from what we've already shared, we'll get that out there as well.